Hello there, my fellow Minecraftians, and you're back with IDED of IDEDOnline for another thermal expansion tutorial. And today we're taking a look at a few more machines, but first up, I wanted to cover this, the pneumatic servo. So the pneumatic servo itself, as you can see there, is something that's installed into pipes. So how do you make one of these pneumatic servos? Well, what you'll need is two pieces of glass, either side in the middle there, in the direct center, a piece of redstone, and then a iron ingot above and below that in the middle. So there we go. So that's the actual recipe, and that'll pop you out one of these pneumatic servos, which then you can install into a pipe. So to use the pneumatic servo, what you're going to need is a pipe connected to an inventory. So right here, I've actually put in this chest here. If you don't put it into, well, you can put it into any pipe, but if you don't put it into one with an inventory next to it, you won't be able to access it. So you need an inventory there so you can actually access it. To access it, once it's connected like this, you just need to right click on it, and there you go, you get this, the item filter, and it's telling you where it's actually sulfur at the moment, where it's filtering from. So here you can dictate if it's an output version, then you can actually show you which kind of stack size you're going to actually output. So you can dictate if you want to output 1 all the way up to 64. Now you also have these options over here. So let's actually have a quick look at what this actually is. So you've got a blacklist and you've also got a whitelist. So basically the blacklist means that any item in here of that type of the blacklist on will not be outputted via it. If you have a whitelist, then only the items in here will be outputted via it. So that's the difference between the whitelist and blacklist. Then you've also got use metadata. Now this picture here is a good definer for it. What that means is metadata is like the number that comes after the original item ID. So here it's got a picture of a pick where it's slightly worn down. That means that if you had one here and you had this turned on, then basically it would only output picks with that amount of damage on it. This also counts for different things, like let's say for example different states of logs. Some walls are obviously using different variations, and so if you don't have metadata on it, it would just output any wall. Now you also want to look at this, which is the use or dictionary. Now not a lot of people are familiar with what the or dictionary is. Now as part of Forge, this thing called the or dictionary, which is actually used to combine different ores. So it means that the ore, let's say from Tinker's Construct, could be used with an ore from Thermal Expansion. Either one is interchangeable in any crafting recipe. So if you use this and the mod has been programmed in that way to use it, then it means that you could put a copper ingot in here of any type. So let's say the Tinker's Construct copper ingot goes in here, and it would still export ones from Thermal Expansion, Galactic Craft, or any other mod that happens to have copper involved in it. So that's what that's actually used for. So it means it can output any type of the same type of ingot as long as it's been programmed correctly using or dictionary. The other one is MBT. Now I'm not going to go into MBT for you, because this one generally you just always want to have ignore MBT off. It's actually the structural file designation that's actually created by Minecraft itself, and it's been there since the early days, but I don't feel it's relevant because I don't think anyone's ever going to actually really be using this unless you're really advanced with using the mod. Okay, so next up is the Aqueous Accumulator. So the Aqueous Accumulator, that's what it looks like right there, has only one section of its interface, which is this here, and it generates water for you. But we'll go into that in a bit. So first of all, let's have a look at how you actually make one of these. So what you're going to need is a machine frame in the direct center there, which was covered in a previous tutorial. Either sides of that, you're going to need some glass. Above that in the crafting UI, directly in the center, you'll need a bucket. In each corner at the bottom, you're going to need a tin ingot, and in the bottom middle, you're going to need a pneumatic servo, which is what we've just covered previously, and that'll pop you out one of these Aqueous Accumulators. So how do you use this Aqueous Accumulator? Well, as you can see here, I've actually set it up. Now, what the best setup for this is to have two water sources next to it. So as you can see right here, I've actually got one water source, which will enable this to fill up. So if I go over to my chest, which I showed you a minute ago, and take out these items here, and look, here we go. If we actually turn this on, you'll see this tank will start to fill up because I've got it plugged into the top of it. And as soon as we put it to mode input, it fills up with water. And it's actually taking water from inside here, as you can see, the Aqueous Accumulator. Now, that will actually fill up more if we had two water sources, but anything more than two and it won't make any difference. This will not fill up any quicker. And as soon as this actually reaches its top, or if we, let's say, turn this off now and then go back in, you'll see that here it will take a bit of time, but it will slowly but surely fill up. So there you go, 3, 4, 5, 6, and obviously this is configured here to have inputs. Everything around it's an input, and there's no output because obviously if you just put the tank on top of it, which is this one here, you can't actually set it to be specifically outputting from there because there's only one that it can put into or take from. So I always recommend having it with either side like that. With water next to it, you can most probably bury this and put the tank on top of it and it will just actually fill up. And you can see here it doesn't require power, so this will just work independently. So next up, we're going to look at the Glacial Precipitator, and that's what it looks like right there. It's got a UI that looks like this, so you've got your selections up here, you've got the output there, and obviously then you've got this bit here for obviously storing water, and this bit here for obviously your electricity. Obviously the bottom bit there if you want to put a capacitor in there so you can power it using that. So how do you make one of these? Well, what you need is you're going to need yourself a machine frame, which we covered in the previous tutorial in the direct center there. Right above that, you're going to need a piston, right below it, a redstone reception coil. Either side of it, you're going to need a piece of snow, and then in the bottom corners, you're going to need copper ingots, and that'll pop you out one of these glacial precipitators. Okay, so next up is the glacial precipitator. How do you actually use this glacial precipitator? Well, if we look in here, you'll see it does require power, and I've powered this one up to full, and it actually requires water. Now, I've got a bucket of water here, so what I'll do is I'll chuck that in there, and you can see this is filled up, and you can actually dictate what it will make. So at the moment, it's made loads of snowballs for me, and we could take that out, but you can actually select each one off of the top here. Now, obviously, snowball takes the least amount of water, snow blocks will take more water, and obviously, ice block will take the most amount of water from here to create. So that's how those ones work. You can also use a obviously flux capacitor or a capacitor in here. I don't know why I say flux capacitor, I'm going back to the future, but still nonetheless you could put a capacitor in there to charge it up, or you can use a dynamo to charge this one up. And as long as there's water being poured into this, so you could do it from a pipe system, let's say, into here, it will continuously make any one of these, whichever one you dictate, as long as there's enough water available for it. Now you can obviously set up the configuration like you could with the other ones to set outputs and inputs, and if you go back to that tutorial, that shows you exactly how to set all of that up so you can have that working. Okay, and last but not least is the Igneous Extruder. That's what it looks like there in its turned off state. Now this one, as you can see, is like the last one where you've got a selection there for what you can actually output from this one, and that's what it outputs there. You've got two actual inputs here for this one, one being for lava and one being for water, and those two are used to mix together to make these, but we'll go into that very shortly. So how do you make one of these? Well, what you're gonna need is a machine frame in the direct center there. Right below it, you're gonna need a pneumatic servo, which we covered at the start. Above it, you're going to need a piston, and then either side, a piece of glass, and then in the bottom corners, you're going to need 10 ingots like that, two of those, one in each corner, and that'll pop you out one of these igneous extruders. Okay, so now we're going to look at the Igneous Extruder and how it actually works. So as you can see here, this is in its turned off state. And as you can see, it doesn't require power. It just uses anything it can get its hands on. So if we just click, we've got cobblestone selected here, which is the least of each resource used to make it. Stone, which requires a bit more of each resource. And of course, obsidian, which is the most expensive to create. So if we go and fill up, let's say, our water source. So I'm going to grab some water from here. There we go. Should have really grabbed it from inside the tank, but nonetheless, if we put that into it, and we put that into it, you'll see it lights up, and now it's active. And you can see, there you go, it's now generating cobble from the lava and the water source either side, filling up into this bit here. Now you can use the configuration to import into either one of these sections here, and then obviously export from there to actually get the items in and out. So this is a good one to use in conjunction with the Aqueous Accumulator to fill it up with water, so you can have a continuous run. Obviously you could use the magma crucible hooked up on the other side, which we covered in a previous tutorial here, and that would allow you to keep on pumping lava into it too, which will then make you almost a continuous cycle of creating lava and creating rock and then creating more lava and so on and so forth. So that's how that works. It's a really cool little system, and that's how this Igneous Extruder actually works. So I hope you found that useful. That's the end of this tutorial. So that's covered another 3 machines for you. Next time I'll be covering a few more of these, just to give you the last few machines in the actual set for thermal expansion, and then we'll move on to recipes. So remember, if you enjoy this video, give it a like, give it a subscribe, feel free to share my videos with as many people as you can, because obviously every share you do helps me get out to a wider and wider audience, and I'll be really grateful for any help you guys want to offer. So as always, it's been great to have you with me, and until next time, look after yourselves, and I'll catch you soon. So next up is the Aqueous Accumulator. This is the Aqueous Accumulator here, that's what it looks like. And if you can see, this is actually what the inside of it looks like. It's just got this one area here, and it can store water. Basically, it generates water for you. Now, how do you make one of these? Well, you will need yourself a machine frame, which we covered in a previous tutorial in the direct center there. Either side of that, you'll need a piece of glass. You also need a pneumatic servo, which we just covered previously. Okay, let's do that again without the cat.